In the next few lectures, we shall consider some topics in combinatorics. The first one we shall consider is the pigeonhole principle. It is a very simple concept, and we shall consider the concept and then some problems under the principle. The simple form of the pigeonhole principle is like this. If n plus 1 objects are put into n boxes, then at least one box contains two or more of the objects. It's a very simple thing, very easily understandable. So, in fact, it is said something like this: if n plus 1 pigeons are put into n pigeon holes, at least one pigeon hole will contain two or more pigeons. That is why this concept is called the pigeonhole principle. It's a very simple idea. Let us see how this idea can be used to solve some problems. Some of applications are as follows. Among 13 people, there are 2 who have their birthdays in the same month. Because there are only 12 months, there are 13 people, 2 of them will have their birthday in the same month. In very simple concept. The next one is, given m integers a1, a2, am, there exists k and l, where k and l are between 1 and m, such that ak plus 1 plus ak plus 2 plus al is divisible by m. That is, if you take the successive numbers and their sum, that will be divisible by m. If you put it less formally, there exists consecutive a's in the sequence a1, a2, am whose sum is divisible by m. How do you use pigeonhole principle to prove this? To see this, consider the m sums a1, a1 plus a2, a1 plus a2 plus a3. Consider a1. A1 plus A2, A1 plus A2 plus A3 and so on. There are m such sums. If any of these sums is divisible by m, then obviously the conclusion holds. The result follows. So, thus we may assume that each of these sums has a non-zero remainder when divided by m. That is, none of these sums are divisible by m. And so, when divided by m, they will leave some remainder, and that is non-zero. So, it will be from 1 to m minus 1, one of the integers from 1 to m minus 1. The remainder will be equal to one of the integers 1, 2, 3 up to m minus 1. Now, we have m sums and only m minus 1 remainder, m minus 1 possible values for the remainders. Two of the sums will have the same remainder when divided by n. Therefore, there are two integers k and l, and let us assume that l is greater than k, such that a1 plus a2 plus ak leaves the remainder say r when divided by m, and a1 plus a2 plus a3 up to al also leaves the same remainder r when divided by m. That means a1 plus a2 plus ak is equal to some b into m plus r, where b is an integer, and a1 plus a2 plus a3 up to al is cm plus r, where C is an integer. Now L is greater than K, so subtract this from this. You will find that AK plus 1 up to AL, that is the remaining elements from here after AK, that is equal to C minus B into M, that is where C is an integer, B is an integer, so C minus B is an integer. And this sum AK plus 1 up to AL is divisible by M. Thus, we prove that AK plus 1 AK plus 2 up to AL is divisible by M. This is another simple application. There are strong forms of the pigeonhole principle. Let us consider them. The same idea, but extended in a slightly different way. Let Q1, Q2, Qn be positive integers. If Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 plus Qn minus n plus 1 objects are put into n boxes, then either the first box contains at least Q1 objects or the second box contains at least Q2 objects and so on, or the nth box contains at least Qn objects. This is again very simple. Let us see. There are n boxes, 1, 2, 3 n, and there are Q1 plus Q2 plus Qn minus n plus 1 objects. Suppose the first box contains less than Q1 objects, maximum it can handle is Q minus 1. And if it contains less than Q2 objects, the maximum it can contain is Q2 minus 1. And proceeding like this, the maximum number this can have is Qn minus 1 if the nth box contains less than Qn minus 1 elements. So the total number of elements you can have in all the boxes will be Q1 plus Q2 plus Qn minus n. In this case, so if you have Q1 plus Q2 plus Qn minus n plus 1 objects, at least one of the boxes will contain more than the supposed element. That is, either the first box will contain Q1 objects or more, or second box will contain Q2 objects or more, or the third box will contain Q3 or more objects, or the nth box will contain Qn or more objects. Putting it in another way, making use of, suppose Q1 is equal to Q2 is equal to Q3, etc. Suppose n into r minus 1 plus 1 objects are put into n boxes, then at least one of the boxes contains r or more objects. If each box contains less than r object, the maximum it can contain is r minus 1. So the totally in n boxes, you can have only n into r minus 1 objects. But now there are n into r minus 1 plus 1 objects. So at least one of the boxes will contain r or more objects. Putting it in another way, this is another form of the statement. If n integers m1, m2, mn have an average m1 plus m2 plus mn by n. Because if you have n integers, the average is given by this number. And if the average is greater than r minus 1, then at least one of the integers m1 plus m2 mn is greater than or equal to r. Because otherwise, the average will not be greater than r minus 1. So these are different ways of putting the pigeonhole principle. Depending upon the application, we take the proper. The idea is very simple, but when we use it to solve problems, we have to think and apply it in a proper manner. Let us consider some problems. A man hiked 10 hours and covered a total distance of 45 miles. It is known that he hiked 6 miles in the first hour and only 3 miles in the last hour. Show that he must have hiked at least 9 miles within a certain period of 2 consecutive hours. So this is the problem. A man hiked for 10 hours. So let A1, A2, A10 be the number of miles he hiked in the ith hour. So AI is the number of miles he hiked in the ith hour. Of course, I will vary from 1 to 10. Now, we know that A1 is 6 and A10 is 3. And it is said that we have to prove that consecutive 2 hours, he would have hiked at least 9 miles. Suppose not. Suppose he has not hiked 9 miles or more in any 2 consecutive hours. Then what does that mean? A1 plus A2 is less than 9. A2 plus A3 is less than 9 and so on. A9 plus A10 is less than 9. So adding you will get A1 plus 2 times A2 up to A9 plus A10 is less than 9 times 9, 81. Add one more A1 and A10, but we know that A1 and A10 are 6 and 3 respectively, so that is equivalent to adding 9. You get that 2 times sigma AI is less than 90 or sigma AI is less than 45, which would mean it is contradicting the fact that he has hiked 45 miles in 10 hours. So, but we know that the man hiked for 10 hours and covered a total distance of 45 miles. So, if you assume that he has not hiked 9 miles or more in any 2 consecutive hours, we come to the conclusion that the total distance covered by him is less than 45, which is not true. So, we are arriving at a contradiction, and that would mean that he has hiked 9 miles or more in some consecutive hour, at least in some consecutive hour. Let us take some more examples. The circumference of a roulette wheel is divided into 36 sectors, to which the numbers 1 to 36 are assigned in some arbitrary manner. Show that there are 3 consecutive sectors such that the sum of their assigned numbers is at least 56. Again, this problem is very similar to this one. You have a circumference circle which is divided into 36 possible ways, A1, A2, A3 and so on, A36, and each of them is assigned a number between 1 to 36, and the problem says that we have to show that at least in one place, 3 consecutive sectors, the sum will add up to 56 or more. Suppose not. In the same idea, if A1, A2, A3 are assigned, suppose the conclusion is not true, then you have A1 plus A2 plus A3 is less than or equal to 55. If it is not 56 or more, it has to be less than or equal to 55. Similarly, A2 plus A3 plus a4 is less than or equal to 55, and proceeding like that, a35 plus a36 plus a1 is less than or equal to 55, a36 plus a1 plus a2 is less than or equal to 55. Now add up this, you will get a1 is occurring in 3 places, a2 is occurring in 3 places. So the sum will be sigma 3 times sigma a, that will be less than or equal to 55 into 36. There are 36 inequalities. Adding the right hand side of the inequalities, you get this. But what is sigma I? Each AI is between 1 and 36. The numbers 1 and between the numbers between 1 and 36 are assigned to A1, A2, A3. So this will be 3 into sigma AI will be 36 into 37 by 2, because the sum of the first 10 integers is given by n into n plus 1 by 2. Here the sum of the first 36 integers is given by 36 into 37 by 2. That is less than or equal to 55 into 36. Cancelling 36 on both sides, you will get 3 into 37 is 111. 111 is less than or equal to, taking the 2 on the other side, you will get 110. So you get the result 111 is less than or equal to 110, which is not correct. So you are arriving at a contradiction. So the result follows, that is, there are 3 consecutive sectors such that the sum of their assigned numbers is at least 56. You can see the similarity between this problem and the previous problem. The third one is, and you can also see the application of the pigeonhole principle. The third one is like this. From the integers 1 to 200, 101 of them are chosen arbitrarily. Show that among the chosen numbers, there exists 2 such that one divides another. So the numbers are between 1 and 200, 1 to 200, and you are selecting 101 of them. Show that there are at least 2 where one will divide the other. Now this can be solved in this manner. You have 100 holes or 100 holes or boxes, one for the odd numbers 1, 3, 5, 7, like that. There are 100 boxes, 100. Take a number, if you pick a number I, express I as some r into 2 power k. Each number you can express like this, r into 2 power k, where k will be greater than or equal to 0. For example, if I take 55, that is 55 into 2 power 0, you can write like that. If I take, say, 112 is how many times, 7 into 2 power 4, isn't it, 16 into 7, 112. You can write like this. Now whenever you have a number like this, you write it as r into 2 power k. So put this number in the box corresponding to r. So if I have selected 55, I will put 55 in the box corresponding to 55. If I had selected 112, I will put it in the box corresponding to 7. So when I select 101 numbers out of 200 numbers and put them in the boxes corresponding to these like this, by the pigeonhole principle, one box will contain at least two elements, Suppose a particular box X contains two elements, then there are two numbers M is equal to X into 2 power P. This box corresponding to X, X is an odd number, it contains two elements M and N. Then M can be represented as X into 2 power P, N will be represented as X into 2 power P. Now obviously P will be less than Q, or one of them will be less than the other. P and Q cannot be equal because M and N are different. Suppose M is greater than N, then P will be greater than Q, and M is divided by N, and M by N will be equal to 2 power P minus Q. So M is divided by N. There are two numbers such that one divides the other. So we prove the result. So you can see how the pigeonhole principle is applied here. The next is select, it is a continuation of this, select 100 integers from the integers 1 to 200 such that no one of them is divisible by any other. So from 1 to 200 you are asked to select 100 of them so that no two of them are such that one divides other. If you select 101, 102 to 200, you will realize that none of them divides the other. The, you can see like this, argue out like this, even if you take the least element and the smallest multiply by the smallest integer, it will be 202 which exceeds this. So this will not divide any of this, and similarly any one of them will not divide the other. That is one argument. And when we consider the earlier thing, try to express each one of them as X into 2 power some k, and try to put in one, each one in one of the pigeonholes, 1, 3, 5, 7, etcetera, these 100 pigeonholes, you will realize that these 100 numbers will be put in 100 different boxes, each one will contain only one of them. You can try that and check whether it is correct. No two of them will be put in the same box. So you can take it as an exercise and try to putting these numbers into those 100 boxes. The next problem is also a somewhat similar one. Show that given any 52 integers, there exist two of them whose sum or else whose difference is divisible by 100. The numbers can range in any way. So let a1, a2, a52 be the integers. They are some integers, and you are asked to show that there are two of them such that the sum will be divisible by 2 or the difference will be divisible by 2. You can always select 2 from these 52 integers such that the sum or the difference of will be divisible by 100. How do you prove that? Now any number ai you can express as 100 k plus bi. We can express a number like this, ai is equal to 100 k plus bi, where what is the range for bi? It will be from 0 to 99. Now let us consider some boxes like this corresponding to 0, 1, 2, 49, 50 boxes. You consider 51 boxes like this. If the BI, any number AI is of the form 100K plus BI. Now, if BI is 0, you put it here. If BI is 50, you put it here. If BI is equal to 1 or 99, you put it here in the box corresponding to 1. So, you put BI in the box J if BI is equal to J or 100 minus J. Now, how many boxes are there? There are 51 boxes there. And how many numbers are there? There are 52 numbers. So, by the pigeonhole principle, two of them will be put in the same box. So, two numbers, say AM and AN, will be in the same box because of the pigeonhole principle. Suppose AM is equal to some 100 times K plus BM, and AN is 100 times L plus BN. They are in the same box, and let the box be the jth box, box J. So, BM is J or 100 minus J, BN is also J or 100 minus J. Suppose BM is the same as BN, then AM minus AN will be 100 times K minus L. So, the difference is divisible by 100. Suppose BM is J and BN is 100 minus J. Suppose BM is J and BN is 100 minus J, say. Then AM plus AN will be 100 into K plus L plus BN will be 100 plus 100. So, the sum AM plus AN will be divisible by 100. So, any number AI you express as 100K plus BI, where BI will be from 0 to 99, and you consider 51 boxes like this, 0, 1, 2 corresponding to 50, and you put a number in a corresponding box J. If BI is J or 100 minus J. For example, if BI is 1, you will put here. If BI is 99 also, you will put here. If BI is 2, you will put here. If BI is 98 also, you put it here. Like that you put. Because there are 52 numbers and 51 boxes, at least one of them will contain two numbers by the pigeonhole principle. And suppose AM and N, AM are in the same box J, then AM you can write in the form 100K plus BM, and AN you can write as 100L plus BN, where BM will be J or 100 minus J, and BN also will be J or 100 minus J. If they are the same, consider the difference will be divisible by 100. If one is J and another is 100 minus J, consider the sum of the two numbers, the sum will be divisible by 100. So, this way we can prove that given any 52 integers, there exists two of them whose sum or else whose difference is divisible by 100. Take another problem. Let us go through the statement of the problem carefully. A student has 37 days to prepare for an examination. From past experience, she knows that she will require no more than 60 hours of study. She also wishes to study at least 1 hour per day, so that no matter how she schedules her study time, a whole number of hours per day, however, there is a succession of days during which she will have studied exactly 13 hours. A student has 37 days to prepare for an exam, and she needs to prepare for 60 hours. A student has 37 days to prepare for an examination. From the past experience, she knows that she will require no more than 60 hours of study. She also wishes to study at least 1 hour per day, so that no matter how she schedules her study time, there is a succession of days during which she will have studied exactly 13 hours. Suppose on the first day she studies she has studied for A1. At the end of the second day, she has studied for A2 hours. At the end of the third day, she has studied for A3 hours. That is, the first day she studies for A1 hours. The second day, first and second day put together, she studies for A2 hours. And the third day, that is the first 3 days, she has studied A3 hours, and so on. So, on the 37th day, she has studied for 60 hours. So, this is an increasing sequence. So, every day she, AI is the number of hours she has studied up to 8th day. So, this particular sequence is an increasing sequence, because every day she studies at least 1 hour. And these numbers are between 1 and 60. Because maximum she studies only for 60 hours. And consider this sequence. Now, what we want to prove is, in a consecutive days, she has exactly studied 13 hours. That is, some say AJ minus AI is equal to 30, where J is greater than I. This is what we want to show. Now, consider this sequence: A1 plus 13, A2 plus 13, etc., A37 plus 13. A1, A2, A3, AN is an increasing sequence. So, we are adding 13 to every number. So, A1 plus 13, A2 plus 13, A3 plus 13, A37 plus 13, that is also an increasing sequence, and all numbers are all different. So, this is an increasing sequence. And the values will range from 13 to 73. A37 is 60, So 60 plus 13, 73. The values will range between these two, 13 and 73. So now consider the numbers A1, A2, A37. A1 plus 13, etc. up to A37 plus 13. How many numbers are there here? 37 plus 37. 74 numbers are there. And the value is AI ranges from 1 to 60. The other sequence, the numbers range from 13 to 73. So these numbers, the value ranges between 1 to 73. These numbers are between 1 to 73. And there are 74 such numbers. So two of them will be equal. Obviously, by the pigeonhole principle, two of them will be equal. Now, you know that none of these numbers are equal because every day she studies at least 1 hour. These numbers are all different, and these numbers are all again different because with each number you are adding 13. So the fact that two of these are equal would mean that sum AJ will be equal to sum AI plus 13. Okay, obviously J has to be greater than I. So AJ minus AI will be 13. That is, from the I plus 1th day till the jth day, she has exactly studied for 13 hours. That is, from the I plus 1th day to jth day, she has studied for 13 hours. So you can see how the pigeonhole principle is applied here. Let us take one more problem. Suppose that in a group of 6 persons, each pair are either friends or enemies. Prove that among 6, either there are 3 persons who are mutual friends, each is a friend of the other, or else there are 3 persons who are mutual enemies, each is an enemy of the others. Also show that this is not true for 5 persons. So you can consider it like this. You are having 6 persons A, B, C, D, E, F. If A and B are friends, I will put a line like this. Straight line. If A and B are enemies, I will put a line like this. So if you have, if X and Y are friends, you consider like this. If X and friends, X and Y are enemies. Consider A and consider 3 of his friends. See, there are 5 people. And either he will have 3 friends or 3 enemies, right? If A has three friends, you can proceed in a following manner. Either among the five, there are possibilities are A has, there are other, apart from A, there are five people. The possibility is five friends, friends and enemies. Five friends, no enemies. Four friends, one enemy. Three friends, two enemies. Two friends, three enemies. One friend, four enemies. Zero friend, all enemies. So either A will have three friends or he will have three enemies. Either, this is by pigeonhole principle, either A will have three friends or three enemies. Suppose he has got three friends. We will see how we can deal with the case when he has three enemies. It is similar. Suppose he has three friends. Say suppose B, C and E are his friends, then consider B and C are C and E and B and E. If either B and C are friends, then you have three friends, three mutual friends. Or if E and C are friends, again you are having three friends, mutual friends. If otherwise, if B and E are friends, again you are having three mutual friends. On the other hand, none of them are mutual friends. Suppose B and C are enemies. Suppose C and E are also enemies. And B and E are also enemies. Then you are having three mutual enemies. So, in this case, you are having three mutual enemies. So, either you are having three friends or three mutual enemies. The other way around, supposing A has three enemies and two, three or more enemies. A has three enemies like this. Now consider again B and C. If they are enemies, you are having three mutual enemies. If C and D are enemies like this, you are having three mutual enemies. If B and E are enemies, then again you are having three mutual enemies. Otherwise, if they are not enemies, B and C will be friends, C and E will be friends, and B and E will be friends. So, you are having three mutual friends. So, this shows that if either you have three mutual friends or three mutual enemies among six. Now, the same is not true for five persons A, B, C, D, E. The reason is if you have apart from A, you are have five persons, then either three of them will be friends to A or three of them will be enemies. More than three will be friends or more than three will be, three or more will be enemies. This is because you can put like this. Now, apart from A, there are only four of them. So, two can be friends and two can be enemies. So, the fact that three of them, A will have three friends or three enemies does not hold anymore. So, suppose B is friend to A and E is friend to A and C is enemy to A and D is also enemy to A. I can design in such a way that there are no three people who are friends or there are no three people who are enemies. Now, A and E are friends, A and B are friends. So, suppose it is possible that B and E are enemies and A and D are enemies, A and C are enemies, but C and D can be friends. It can happen like that. Let us draw the other arcs also. Now, in this case, you have to draw this arc 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 arcs we have drawn, 4 more arcs we have to draw. Suppose B and C are friends, right? Then D and C are friends, B and C are friends. It is possible that B and D are enemies. You can have like this. And E and B are enemies, B and D are enemies. So it is possible that D and E are friends, right? So in that case, you do not have three enemies or three friends. And similarly, you are having D and C as friends and D and E as friends. So it is possible that C and D are enemies. Now, if you take any three of these vertices, you will find that no three of them are friends or no three of them are mutual enemies. So it is possible to draw a graph like this with two different types of arcs such that five of them are of one type and five of them are another type, and you have the condition that no three of them are mutual friends or no three of them are mutual enemies. It is possible to draw like this. The reason is, when I say A has, apart from A there are five people of which you put friends and enemies in two boxes, friends and enemies. Five people you try to put of them, one of them should contain three or more, isn't it? A will have either three friends or either it will have he will have three enemies. And in that case, we argued out how you get three mutual friends or three mutual enemies. Now, apart from A, if you have only four people, that condition does not hold. If you have two boxes, friends and enemies, you can put two in each of them, and then the you can construct a graph like this, which shows that there are you don't have three mutual friends or mutual enemies. So the pigeonhole principle is again used here. Let us consider one more problem, which is again similar way. The same idea, very simple idea, but you have two concentric discs. The circumference of the two concentric discs are divided into 200 sections each as shown in the figure. Let us see the figure. You have two concentric circles like this, and the circumference is divided into 200 sectors like this. For the outer disc, 100 of the sections are painted red and 100 of the sections are painted blue. For the inner disc, the sections are painted red or blue in an arbitrary manner. Show that it is possible to align the two discs so that 100 or more of the sections on the inner discs have their colors matched with the corresponding sections on the outer disc. The figure is like this. Now, in one position, you are having a disc like this. Suppose 1 to 200 is there, and similarly here also 1 to 200. How many ways you can align them? First is 1 and 1 can be aligned in a manner, then you can rotate and 2 can come align with 1, then you can again rotate and 3 can come in alignment with 1, so that 2 will come with 200 and 199, 1 will come like this. I am rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. So you can rotate in such a way that you get the next alignment. The first alignment, of course, 1 and 1, if I number them as 1 to 200 and 1 to 200, 1 and 1 will align, 200 and 200 will align, and so on. if I rotate through one sector, then two will align with one and so on. So how many possible alignments can you have? You can have possibly alignment. And the problem is, it is possible to align the two disks so that 100 or more of the sections of the inner disk have their colors matched with the corresponding sections on the outer disk. Now in the outer disk, 100 of them are colored blue. And 100 are painted red. And in the disk, they are arbitrarily painted red or blue. So take in one alignment. In one alignment, suppose this particular disk is colored red. Out of the 200 possible alignments, in 100 possible alignments, it will match with the corresponding sector in the outer disk. So in the 200 alignments, the first sector will match in 100 of the 200 alignments, second sector will also match in 100 of the alignments, third sector will also match in 100 of the alignments and so on. So totally the number of matches will be 200 into 100, 20,000 matches. You count the matches. See, in one alignment you count the matches. In the second element, you count the matches. The third element, you count the matches. Like that, in the 200 alignments, you count the matches. The total number of matches will be 20,000. The reason is, each sector in the inner circle is painted red or blue. And the outer sector, 100 of them are painted red and 100 of them are painted blue. So if you take this sector, which is painted red, in 100 of the alignments, it will match. If you take the next sector, it will be blue or red. So in 100 of them, it will be matching and so on. So if you count the number of matches in all the alignments, it will add up to 20,000. And how many alignments are there? There are 200 alignments. So the average is 100. And if you look at the... So the average is 100. So at least in one alignment, 100 or more of the sectors will match the corresponding colors. Here we are making use of this. If n integers m1, m2, mn have an average which is greater than r minus 1, then at least one of the integers m1 plus m1, m2, mn is greater than r equal to r. So if the number, there are 200 alignments, let us call them as alignment 1, alignment 2 and so on, alignment 200. The number of matches you call it as m1, m2 and m200. The sum is sigma mi is 20,000. So the average sigma mi by 200 is 100. So it is greater than 99. So here in this example, m1, m2, mn represent the number of matches in each alignment, and the average is greater than r minus 1, that is 99. It is at least 100. So at least one of them should be r. The number of matches in at least one of them, m1, m2, mn, m200 is 100 or more. So we are making use of this form of the pigeonhole principle here. So let us recall the pigeonhole principle and the different versions again, and it can be used to solve problems like this. The idea is very simple. But each problem when you tackle, you have to think in a different manner for the solution. The simple form is this. N plus 1 objects are put into n boxes, then at least one box contains two or more of the objects. The stronger forms are like this. Let q1, q2, qn be positive integers. Then if q1 plus q2 plus qn minus n plus 1 objects are put into n boxes, then either the first box contains at least q1 or the second box contains at least q2 and or the nth box contains at least qn objects. The other two forms are like this. If n into r minus 1 plus objects are put into n boxes, then at least one of the boxes contains r or more of the objects. And if you take the another form is, if you take the average of n elements, if it is greater than r minus 1, then at least one will be greater than or equal to r.
Thank you.